I'm Shaun Haney, and this is Real Ag on the Weekend. Let's get real and get connected with the week that was in Canadian agriculture. Real Ag on the Weekend starts now. Welcome to Real Ag on the Weekend here on 650 CKOM and 980 CGME. I'm your host, Shaun Haney of RealAgriculture.com. Hope you had yourself a great week, but winter is here. Yes, cold, nasty, gross. Oh, yuck. And I was joking earlier this week that if you're one of these people that says, oh, I quite frankly, I love winter. It's great. No. You're lying to yourself and everybody else. Although it is, it means we can break out the snow sleds and the snow machines and do some ice fishing, I guess. That is one of the positives. Some of you are downhill skiers, too. You take off to Alberta, hit the mountains, and do some of that kind of stuff, too. But, yeah, it's winter. Thank goodness the crop's off. So, today on Real Ag on the Weekend, we got a lot of ground to cover. If you have any feedback on today's show at all, we'd love to hear from you. Send me an email, shaney@realagriculture.com. Or, of course, you can find us across all the different social media platforms. We are Real Agriculture on all of them. Or you can always call that Real Ag feedback line. The number is 855-776-6147. You dial that number, you press the number 3, and, of course, you leave me a message. So what are we going to talk about today? Well, what are we not going to talk about? We're going to cover today, we're going to get a bit of some crop comments from Colleen Redlick. She is with Corteva and Pioneer Seeds Canada. We're also going to hear from Mike Shewchuk, who is in Blaine Lake as well. They appeared earlier this week on the Real Ag Radio podcast. We'll play that for you. We're going to hear Kelvin Heppner of Real Agriculture. He joined me this week on Real Ag Politics to talk about the unusual situation of what's happening with Bill C-234 and how farm groups are now urging the Senate to basically turn down the Senate Ag Committee's amendments that they passed. So, very unusual situation. He'll shed some light on that. We're also going to hear from Tom Wolfe and Carl deConinck Smith. And they're going to talk about spot spraying. This is a clip from last Monday night's Agronomist. If you've not checked out the Agronomist, I can highly encourage you to do so. And then, you know what? While we're sticking with some of the technology, I want to sort of give a bit of an update what's happening with the Tesla truck. Now, there's going to be some of you out there that have ordered one, and you're still waiting. Tesla put out some comments this week where this thing doesn't seem like it may happen in a really limited basis. If anybody thought that Tesla was taking on the F-150, I think you better reconsider that position. Okay, let's start with Mike Shewchuk. He is in Blaine Lake, Saskatchewan, and I got an update from him on how his crops worked out this year. Here's what he had to say.
I'd say average. Like our yields were probably a little bit below average, pretty close, right around average, I'd say. Commodity prices, I wish they would have, booked in some crops at a better price, but still there's that kind of hangover worry from 21 of, being short on contracts. So a guy's kind of scared to book in crops when they were at a better price at the elevators. So, but overall, I can't complain. It looked, through the summertime, like it wouldn't be much of a crop, but somehow, especially where it caught a few more rains, crops produced. So yeah. I can't really complain too bad.
I also chatted this week with Colleen Redlick, who is an agronomist with Corteva and Pioneer Seeds Canada, and asked her about some of the crop conditions in her area. Her territory is in northeastern Saskatchewan. Here's what she had to say.
Yeah, so I think it was the year of much variability for my area. There's not really a generalization. So I mentioned to you before, my area goes all the way from, Hanley area up to Hudson Bay. So we had a wide range of conditions and saw, anything from 20 bushel an acre yields all the way up to guys in the 70s and 80s. So it was kind of a wild year, and you never knew what to say to somebody because there was so much variability. One positive thing I think we saw with canola, and I said it before, it's kind of a wonderful weed in some ways, is a lot of guys in the Northeast were thinking it wasn't going to be a great crop and had a little bit of late season rain or showers, and crops that they thought were looking at, you know, 25, 30 bushel canola ended up coming off 45, 50. So even though yields were maybe a little lower than some guys were hoping for, I think we did get a few nice surprises, and it really shows the resilience of that canola crop.
Yeah, and on the lower end of the spectrum from a yield standpoint, that's lack of moisture. Because when I hear northeastern Saskatchewan, and this is maybe foolish me, I think of better moisture conditions than, say, what's happening in the southwest corner of the province.
Yes.
But it wasn't all just balloons and rainbows up there in the northeast. There was some lack of moisture there too, right?
That's a good way to put it. It was not all balloons and rainbows and unicorns like maybe they normally get. So yeah, we definitely had some pockets where things were dry and maybe where, you know, we were just wanting moisture at times and not receiving it, right? So things were starting off good. We got unreal establishment, great crops coming. And then the tap kind of just shut off after, you know, June in some places and things got a little dry. So again, I don't think it was a crop failure for a lot of, you know, especially that true northeastern part of my area, but just not maybe what some guys were hoping for out of this year, for sure.
You know, the story still remains the same. You know, no matter, you know, whether your expectations were average or below, whatever you thought you were going to get, it has, for the most part, not everywhere. So I say that with caution to make sure that you don't flood my inbox. There's a lot of acres in Saskatchewan and other parts of Western Canada where the yields were better than people thought they were going to be. And that's okay. That's not bad. I'm not saying bumper crop. And quite frankly, honestly, I've heard the same thing in North Dakota and Montana as well. So that's, you're not alone. Okay, when we come back on Real Ag Radio, we're going to talk about Bill C-234. This is a big deal. It has to do with whether or not we're going to have exemption on the carbon tax on certain agricultural activities. And this bill is really in jeopardy. And it's all because of the Senate. Yes, the Senate. You're like, what? Yeah, the Senate. We'll be right back. You're listening to Real Ag on the Weekend. Of course, we're on 980 CGME and 650 CKOA.
You know, there's a reason we call it the Corn School. Videos on everything from planter setup, weed control, field trial results, yield strategies, and so much more. The Corn School on realagriculture.com has the information and advice you need to help you succeed. Brought to you by Pride Seeds and BASF, Corn School episodes are available at cornschool.com, from realagriculture.com, or as a podcast from your favorite streaming service. Download the latest podcast today.
If you're involved in the agriculture industry, it's important to stay informed on all the latest issues affecting your business. At realagriculture.com, we offer fast, reliable news, information, and insights to help you keep on top of all of the latest in Canadian agriculture. Visit realagriculture.com and sign up for our free daily newsletter covering everything from news, agronomy, animal agriculture, and much more. Visit realagriculture.com/subscribe today.
This segment of Real Ag on the Weekend is brought to you by Sask Canola. They're excited to announce the launch of a new communication platform, an interactive texting service. Farmers who subscribe can expect to receive a weekly oilseeds market outlook report, weekly during the growing season canola production newsletter, plus event notices and urgent news and alerts. Now listen, to subscribe, text keyword Sask Canola to 877-241-7044. This week on the Real Ag Radio podcast and at realagriculture.com, we've been covering what's been going on in the Senate with Bill C-234. We did an interview with Dave Carey of the Canadian Canola Growers Association, where he talked about his concern and how they are now pushing senators to refuse the amendments that the Senate Ag Committee had approved. It's rare that this actually goes this way. Big ask for farm groups, two senators. If it doesn't happen, there's fear that this bill may actually die back in the House. Thanks, Senate. Really appreciate it. So I on Real Ag Politics this week, what I did is we played the interview of Dave Carey, and then I had Kelvin Heppner join me from Real Agriculture, and we discussed what his reaction is and what sources are telling him at this stage. Here's me and Kelvin Heppner. This bill 234, it really fascinating, this whole process as it's unfolded. It's I want to say unprecedented, but the point that we're at here is quite unusual.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what Dave mentioned there several times. There's been a break with convention at numerous points here, and there is going to be another one here if this bill is going to move ahead and not get stranded in the likely not get stranded in the House of Commons. It's going to require another break with convention, and that is senators, when this bill returns to the Senate as a whole in the coming days, are going to have to reject these amendments from the Ag Committee, the Senate's Ag Committee. And that's what farm groups are and farmers are contacting their senators, as Dave talked about now, to have them do that. And that is somewhat of a break from convention. But like Dave said, there's been other places where the government has broken with convention in terms of the makeup of that Ag Committee, swapping in people that aren't normally on the Ag Committee that weren't there for hearing from the witnesses, discuss the merits of the bill. There's been other gamesmanship there with the deputy chair of the committee abstaining on an important vote and, like Dave said, leaving her chair, Senator Rob Black, in the wind. Other just a lot of high school games. You could describe it as in some ways, the Senate is like high school with a lot of trading and people, you help me and I'll help you, that kind of thing happening in the Senate right now.
Feels very earmarky, like the U.S. Okay.
We were joking. We could actually make a TV show about it. And Lindsay suggested Red Seat High would be the name of the TV show about life in the Senate. And specifically, you can make an episode or maybe a season about Bill C-234.
Okay. So you've talked to a lot of sources on this. Now, what's the why? Like, it's a bill about an exemption on a carbon tax. Like, it just feels sort of like in agriculture, we're used to it, you know, being sort of like not very paid attention to. But why is this bill getting so much attention from the government and warranting, from their perspective, some of these unusual measures?
I don't know if I have a good answer on that, Shaun. I think it is kind of an accumulation of a number of different factors, and some of those Dave talked about in that previous segment, including the fact that the carbon tax is a big part of this government's identity on climate. Like, climate is, of course, the number one file for this government in terms of its brand and its identity and how it wants to be known, and it's the legacy it wants to leave. And so the carbon tax is front and center, or the price on pollution, I should say, in their terminology, is front and center on that. So I do think that a big part of it is they don't want to concede any more ground on this, even though there are already exemptions in other areas, including for gasoline and diesel use on farms, and in other sectors there's exemptions as well. And so I think that's a big part of it. There's also the major push on right now to not give up any government revenue or find savings everywhere, and that's where the Parliamentary Budget Officer has found that over the next 8 years, this could potentially result in up to $1 billion in foregone revenues, carbon taxes that would not be collected from farmers if this bill goes through. And so in the big picture, though, $1 billion is not a lot spread out over 8 years for the federal government as a whole. But there is that pressure right now on every single file in the federal government. So I think that is potentially part of this. And then you get into all the just the petty politics of the Senate, as mentioned before, where there might be other bills. I'm not sure. I haven't dug into it this deep, but if there's other bills that the conservatives are holding up that potentially the liberals are wanting to play games here. And it's just the fact that the House of Commons has approved this concept multiple times, both in Bill C-206, which died on the order paper in the Senate when the 2021 election was called. And then now again with C-234, MPs, our elected parliamentarians, have voted in favor of this idea multiple times. And here we still have the Senate running interference on it, which to me, it just seems like it's going beyond the function and the role of the Senate, what we expect the Senate to do here in the Canadian government.
Those independent senators, not so independent now, are we?
Well, exactly. And that's the other thing where there's been a break with convention. As Dave alluded to, there's been not an outright whipping of the vote, but it looks like that might be there might be some of that happening behind the scenes with this progressive senators group that is apparently independent, but still very clearly takes orders from the prime minister's office or the Liberal brain trust or brass.
Yeah. And I guess like there's some irony in your point number two had to do with the, you know, the revenue part of this decision. And, I'm not sure if they've called it revenue neutral, but, you know, I thought that some of this money was supposed to be given back to people. But at the same time, we were told it was not a tax. We should say carbon pricing, a price on carbon, because it wasn't a tax. But then maybe it is a tax. I think being married, as you said there, being married and the way that they have connected, you know, if you were serious about the environment, it's the solution is the carbon tax. And those two things are very, very attached in Canada. Separating them, it's looked upon as this ultimate massive compromise. And the government, you know, from some people on the left where the environmental issues are very, very important, this would be seen as, you know, hey, you're giving up on the environment and you're not fighting climate change. We have a problem. And listen, they're down in the polls. So they've got a problem on the left side of the flank as well.
Yeah, it does seem like it's a hill they're willing to die on kind of thing. But we have seen MPs, Dave alluded to this as well. There's been a movement lately among Cody Bloise's colleagues in Atlantic Canada where they are looking for changes to the federal carbon backstop, the carbon tax. And so there are Liberal MPs that are voicing concerns and speaking out against it. And I do wonder whether that factors into this. Ultimately, this position that the senators are taking under direction from higher up is also a political move. And the benefactors of Bill C-234, of course, largely are probably not voting for the Red Party. And so I think that's also something that we have to take into the equation when figuring out why they're making such an effort to block this.
Well, I use this as an example on Wednesday's RealAg radio show to talk about this is what your checkoff dollars are for. This is funding organizations to be able to have the resources and the capacity. And mind you, there's a number of different issues happening right now in Ottawa, not just 234. But this is a good example where, like, there's a moment in time here where they have to act fast with high volume and influence as many senators as possible to do the right thing for agriculture. And that takes money. And so I made the point to connect those dots for people.
Yeah, for sure. That makes a lot of sense. And it's not just money in the moment. You have to have those people in place who have the relationships that you can ramp it up when there needs to be pressure applied like this. You can't just fly somebody into Ottawa and, hey, I'm so-and-so and I represent so-and-so, please listen to me. You need those relationships and you need, that sustained presence there for situations such as this. And in many ways, the campaign that the Ag Carbon Alliance and other farm groups are rolling out right now is somewhat also breaking with convention, because it's not normal that senators get all these calls to their offices from personal individual Canadians at this point in the process. But that's where they feel that this effort is needed to get this bill across the finish line. So all around, like Dave said, this bill has not been treated normally as most other bills are when they go through the Senate, especially private members' bills like this. But
highly encourage you to go to realagriculture.com or listen to the Real Ag Radio podcast and hear that conversation with Dave Carey of the Canadian Canola Growers Association talking about Bill 234. And big thanks to Kelvin Heppner for providing his insight on this matter as well. Okay, when we come back here on Real Ag on the Weekend, we're going to talk to Tom Wolf and Carl deConinck Smith, both of Saskatchewan. We're talking about high-tech spraying stuff like spot spraying right after this.
Canola is more than just a pretty face in the prairie landscape. It's a big business, both here and around the world, that requires you to be informed and up-to-date on everything it takes to grow a successful crop. The Canola School on realagriculture.com has an expert library of video resources covering markets, agronomy, and more to help you grow a healthy and profitable canola crop. Visit canolaschool.com today. Brought to you by BASF Canada and Invigor Hybrid Canola.
The next generation is the future of agriculture, but how do we launch from one role to leading? From succession planning and family dynamics to understanding finances and making the tough calls to discovering paths others have taken all through agriculture, the Successors Podcast covers it all. Tune in with me, your host, Kara Oosterhuis, simply by searching The Successors on your favorite podcast platform, or you can find it by visiting www.realagriculture.com.
Whether you're seeding, harvesting, or anything in between, the Wheat School on RealAgriculture.com has you covered. Timely agronomic information from industry experts available online anytime. Give your wheat crop a good start and a great finish with the Wheat School on RealAgriculture.com. Brought to you by C&M Seeds, Syngenta Canada, and the Alberta Wheat and Barley Commission.
Welcome back to Real Ag on the Weekend. Well, on Monday nights, Real Agriculture has a primetime show. It's called The Agronomist, and host Lindsay Smith does a fantastic job. The show is so educational, so great. Experts from across Canada and the U.S. And it just so happens this last week, it was all about spot spraying and some of the latest technology in spraying. And two of the experts were from Saskatchewan. So we had Carl deConinck Smith from West Central Saskatchewan, and we had Tom Wolf of Agrometrics and Sprayers 101 from Saskatoon, and they chatted with host Lindsay Smith. Here's a portion of the conversation. I encourage you to check out The Agronomists on YouTube or wherever you get your podcasts. You can find it at realagriculture.com as well. Here's the show. Tom starts off talking about what's the difference between green-on-green and green-on-brown.
So green on brown is really the first iteration of spot spraying, and it means that the sensor, be it a camera or some other kind of sensor, simply can tell if something is green or has chlorophyll versus the bare ground or trash or residue. So that was the first kind of spot spray that came on the market. It actually was in Saskatchewan in 1992 already, and used NDVI, the thing that we use to sort of assess greenness of a crop nowadays. NDVI is still one of the mechanisms of one of the spot spray systems, the one by Trimble, the Wheat Seeker does that. And but there's a new one, this is the one that Carl uses, which detects chlorophyll. So it's not the color green, but the presence of living plant material. So that's green on brown, good for pre-seed burn-off, fallow, that kind of a thing. And then green on green can use the same sensors if you do some thresholding work. Maybe Carl will explain more about that in a moment, but primarily uses cameras, RGB video cameras, and uses artificial intelligence algorithms to detect the shape of the target, the color of the target, other features the target might have, and be able to determine whether that is a desirable or an undesirable plant, crop or weed, maybe even what kind of weed, and then makes a decision to spray that weed. So you can use the green-on-green in-crop, and you can sometimes use the green-on-brown in-crop, but mostly it's fallow. 4 years ago, we spoke to Blue River. They had been purchased by John Deere already, and we just asked them, when are you coming to the field? They had no announcements. They were cagey. They weren't prepared to go public with any of their technology. I met with the fellows from Green Eye Technology at Agritechnica, and they were just really getting started. Both of those technologies are now for sale. Agrifac was there. Well, Blue River wasn't there in person, but they were represented by the Excel group of companies. So I saw the Bilberry system on a few systems, and they were just getting started in Australia. And now they're everywhere. So, yeah, a lot has happened.
Mm-hmm. Specifically with kochia, but some of these tough to kill weeds, how critical is it that we do the best job possible when we spray?
Such an interesting evolution in that thinking, Lindsay, in the weed science community. When I started in weed science, you know, not that long ago, we were always trying to get people to go to thresholding and sort of say, look, I don't have enough weeds to justify spraying. The few weeds that are present are not causing much economic damage, and we should really leave them and minimize the spray passes. Now that we have the pigweeds, the water hemp's, and the Palmer amaranth, particularly in the U.S., but coming into Manitoba, and certainly now that we have the kochia, the thinking has changed. And, you know, I would say Ohio State probably put it best when they said, leave no pigweed behind. In other words, no thresholding for pigweeds. Every pigweed must be gone from that field because the price of allowing a resistant pigweed to survive and multiply in your field is too high. They may produce up to, you know, if you listen to Peter Sikkema, up to 1 million seeds on a water hemp per plant. I mean, if allowed to grow to a full height, of course. But we all know that it's the seed bank will just become so predominantly resistant that it creates a future problem that we may not be able to put a, you know, get a handle on. So that the critical part of this is that the spot spray systems are able to meet those criteria that we, in fact, do spray every weed that is in the field. And if we can't, then that's a problem. The problem that I see really with the industry is not a practice by any particular farmer, but you know, when we're recommending more expensive tank mixes, sort of the multiple effective mode of action philosophy that Carl alluded to, you know, we're kicking the problem down the road, right? We're buying ourselves time, but we're not really solving the problem because it's just really inevitable, judging by past history, that the weeds we're trying to control with these multiple effective modes of action will eventually also become resistant by some mechanism or other to the herbicides that we're choosing to use on them. And, you know, so I think we can probably predict that at some point in the future, we're going to have to find another way of controlling those weeds. And the spot sprays allow us to buy that time by using the more expensive tank mixes and going after the few weeds that have survived and making sure they don't go to seed, because it's cost effective to do a spot spray on that second pass.
Mm-hmm. Really a great observation for the shift from the chemical cost to the time cost, right? So, and time is maybe not always a cash cost, but there are only 24 hours in a day and there's only so many people. So what can you get done in a day?
It's a really cool point. I think time is a cash cost because it's opportunity cost, because the question isn't how much does it cost you to be out there, but what could you be doing with that time that may be profitable. And that you have to think about that. So if you can spend a couple hours in the field going after your survivors as opposed to days, that's huge.
Yeah, that's huge.
Might be a little bit of a for another day, but that's where I think autonomy and spot spraying are really going to fit hand in hand. I know there's a few systems and we're definitely looking into that, because it's an easy operation. It's just a time operation, essentially, is what it is.
Mm-hmm. So Peter Johnson, I don't know, Carl, if you can see the comments, but Peter Johnson reads your mind, which I will alert you. It's a bit terrifying, but he says time. So will we go to swarms of autonomous sprayers here soon, like Australia? So this is part of the mix, right? Is that we are rapidly, and as we've alluded to, you know, 4 years ago versus now, the difference between, you know, on the showroom floor to in field with several, you know, years under our belt of some of these, the idea of time and targeting these specific weeds, to me, those autonomous, you know, applications just become that other layer, another layer of what we could be doing.
They're here now. Yeah. We're actually going to go southern Alberta on this week. The swarm farm is actually in Alberta now, so hopefully this week we'll get to see that.
Tom, so when we talk about the green on brown, it's either detecting, you know, green or chlorophyll, and differentiating that way. And then, of course, then we look at some of these units that are actually, as you mentioned, you know, they're determining perhaps leaf shape and some different parts of this, but that's machine learning. So how good are the algorithms?
Amazingly good, and getting better fast, better than a human being by a long shot.
Like, so even like a Peter Sikkema?
No, we can't touch Peter Sikkema. There's some things no machine can do. But I guess it's the speed, you know. I mean, the ability to identify a weed by species is probably still a human skill that the machines are trying to get to. But the speed at which they can do it is really machine specific. We're literally driving across the field at 15 miles per hour. And it's able to scan, let's say a square meter ahead per camera, maybe a couple of square meters ahead per camera, depending on the spacing of the cameras, finding plants, separating them from weeds, separating weeds from crops, I guess, and then making a spray decision based on a threshold that they've been asked to respond to. we're basically hitting most weeds at speed with an algorithm that no one really understands, right? It may have 100 million parameters. It's a huge mathematical equation. We don't know what's in it. ChatGPT-4 now will respond to uploads of pictures, and it will do weed identification on ChatGPT-4. It will identify crops from weeds. It will speculate on which weeds they are, and it'll speculate whether they might be resistant based on its algorithm. So this is not a trained model on crops and weeds in Western Canada, but it's able to provide some decent answers. So it's, things are moving fast. I mean, that's not enough to spray on. We still have to have a trained data set, but wow, the algorithms are very good. Now, there are size threshold issues, and I think those are Western Canadian and even Eastern Canadian specific. We need to spray when the weeds are small here. Much of the testing for these algorithms has been done in row crops in the U.S. and elsewhere, cotton, corn, and soybeans, where spraying might be a little later. And it might be, you know, the weeds might be a couple of inches across, which is easy peasy for AI. In early season spray weed removal, we need to spray weeds that are maybe half an inch across. And now that is going to be tough. And we still don't have a good sense of how good these algorithms can be. They do have the option of doing a broadcast spray simultaneous to a spot spray. And I think maybe you have something to say about that, Carl. But that's very useful.
Yeah, I don't think there are systems coming out that are dual tank. That's definitely going to be, I mean, that's the next step on what I'm doing now, you know, to be able to target a different plant or a different species independently of something else, that would be that opens up a whole nother box of what you think that you can do. Tom's right. I mean, that's where it's going. It's just the algorithms that they have now or really aren't there for everything now. I think the two first that Bilberry came out with is the broadleafs in cereals and grasses in canola, of course, which are, you know, the two simplest. Yeah. The other side of that, though, that's also your cheapest pass for a broadcast pass. So you're not really solving necessarily yet the hardest of our most difficult, expensive problems yet.
There are some great facts there from Carl and Tom. And speaking of facts, let me tell you about Ag Expert, the software for field and finance. It's not a hunch when it's backed by facts. Uncover your facts at agexpert.ca/farmwithfacts. We'll be back with more here on Real Ag on the weekend right after this.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith of RealAgriculture.com. Join me Monday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern for The Agronomists, Canada's only live, interactive, agronomy-based show. Each week, we answer your most pressing questions with a rotating panel of agronomists, researchers, and extension staff from across Canada. Join me Monday nights, 8 p.m. Eastern on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, or LinkedIn, or head to realagriculture.com/live at 8 p.m. Eastern.
Hi, I'm Bernard Tobin, host of the Soybean School on RealAgriculture.com. Throughout the year, on the Soybean School, we'll bring you timely agronomic video content from planting to harvest, from the latest agronomic research to the latest in production technology. Check out our massive video library on YouTube, RealAgriculture.com, or download the audio podcast versions wherever you get your podcasts. The Soybean School is brought to you by Pride Seeds, BASF, and Syngenta Canada.
It was a number of years ago that Tesla announced they were coming out with the Cybertruck. And we can make a lot of fun of what it looked like. The concepts were ridiculous. Now, the idea is cool. If we could have a pickup truck that is electrified and there's no power compromise, there's going to be interest to people. No doubt. Now, for many of you, hey, you know what? You're sticking with the diesel engine. By the way, if you have not heard my interview with Douglas Brunt about the story of Rudolf Diesel, the man that created the diesel engine, I encourage you to check that out at realagriculture.com. But The Tesla truck, the Cyber Truck, as it has been called. Now, people placed orders. I actually know a few Saskatchewan farmers that did place an order for a Cyber Truck. But this week, now Barron's has a story talking about the Tesla earnings call, where, as the story says, Elon Musk and management went out of their way to manage investor expectations about the closely watched Cybertruck launch, citing the difficulty of the ramp into the 2024 and the negative impact the truck could have on margins and cash flow over the next 18 months, Jonas said in a research note. So Tesla also offered cautious commentary on the macroeconomic environment from rising interest rates, waning consumer strength, and low affordability, the analyst said, cutting its forecast for 24, and their price target shares fell 9.3%, so not good. There was also a story in the Wall Street Journal talking about how there's some real kind of backlash against EVs right now. Of course, EVs have become a little bit political, where it's like a political statement on whether or not you have an electric vehicle or not. I kind of, to be honest with you, I kind of find that a little bit silly in many ways. There's also a lot of concern if there is a flip in the White House in 2024 that there could be some real issues when it comes to some of the incentives that have been put to the EV industry and things like that, right? So if a Republican won the White House, they would take away some of those incentives to say, hey, we support the energy industry. Now, I'm always a little bit confused, not to get off topic here, but I'm always a little bit confused. Why can't we have both? I think we can. Does it have to be all or none? I think there's a lot of reasons to be critical of the Biden White House in terms of like it's EVs or nothing. We don't even have the infrastructure in place and we're like banning gasoline engines in some states and some Democrat states. And then we have the other side of the aisle that basically says this is insane, we can't have EVs, and we need to burn petrol forever. I don't know if either of those really need to be the way, but, you know, hey, that's some nuance that's never discussed in today's political climate whatsoever. But it sounds like the truck, they're having a hard time producing it. It sounds like they're having major cost overruns, and it sounds like, as the article in Barron says, there's an issue with the margins. That's not good for what the... And so there, I saw a few tweets out there from people that follow the auto industry really starting to wonder whether or not this truck actually does really hit the market, which would be... You know, there's not very often negative news around Tesla. There's not a lot of kind of product failures around Tesla. But they may have bitten off a little more they can chew with this truck. And you do have to wonder, if the Wall Street Journal article is correct, okay? And there are, whether or not you have an EV is now like a political representation, well, who drives the most trucks? People that are conservative, because they're in rural areas. That's who votes conservative. You got to wonder if this truck's ever going to make it. I would love to know if you've ordered one. I'd like to know if you've heard any communication from the company. And what are your thoughts now? Do you think this is actually going to hit the market? I think it needs a body change. That's a whole nother thing. But yeah, you can let me know. My email address is shaney@realagriculture.com. Okay, if you have any feedback on today's show, of course, we always love to hear from you. You can send me an email, shaney@realagriculture.com. You can also find us across all the different social media applications. The other option is to call the Real Ag listener line. That number is 855-776-6147. Well, it was great to be with you here today on Real Ag on the weekend. Make sure you check out realagriculture.com. And if you do not get our free e-newsletters, I encourage you to go to realagriculture.com/subscribe. to make sure you get that Western Canadian edition that hits your inbox 6 days a week. Well, thanks so much for getting real and getting connected with Real Ag on the weekend here on 650 CKOM and 980 CGME. Cheers, everybody.